responses, I was like, get it, document it, make that way so I don't
That's exactly how
I was so thankful. I was like, I'm glad she's moderated there, because I was like, check mark, handwritten in, check mark, all of them are covered, there's not a single thing that's remaining.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, he is.
He's chatter.
He was fun.
Oh, he got it.
Yeah, I had to see him before she said the name.
I am tongue-tied today, so if I say
anything
correctly,
I'm just over there trying to say that those see over everything. So, call to order, Budget and Finance Committee. Item number one, approve the contract with Yellow Breeches, or Yellow Breeches, for the 2018-19, 2019-2020 school years. Questions?
Cut and dried, 2-0.
Consent?
Thank you.
Item number two, approve the contract appointing Keystone Collections Group for current and delinquent per capita tax collections. Questions? Discussion? Consent? Item number three, approve the agreement with the Meadows for 2019-2020 and 2020-2021 for educational services, $67 per day on an as-needed basis.
Yeah, I'm sure that's probably the
This is behavioral health, if I'm correct. Any discussion? Consent?
Did you get that?
I printed one last night in case it's different.
Item number four, approve the agreement with the new story for 2019 extended school year. Item number five, approve the general agreement with the Vista School Academic Program. Questions, consent? Item number six, adopt the resolution implementing homestead and farmstead exclusions for the 2019-2020 fiscal year.
Consent?
So those items, I mean, if you have any discussion.
Item number seven, approve stock and leader as the district solicitor July 1st, 2019 to June 30th, 2020. Discussion? Consent?
Do it. Let's play that out.
I did have discussion points, but I didn't know you'd be sitting on
jokes. I'm used to it. I've been a part of all the discussions, but we appreciate the recommendation.
Item number eight, approve the printer copier lease agreement with Docio for
Docio.
I was close.
I met their president once, so that's why I remember his name.
$3,801.33 per month. Is this new?
We have not worked out. They will be a new contractor coming in, a new vendor, but it is a significant savings from what we currently have. Tom went out and got three quotes, did a great job with it, and they came in at a savings.
Do we have a...
Are they replacing Philips?
They are.
They're usually replacing things. I've seen their rate before. I said we had them for a time in our
month. Good thing.
Your existing lease.
Okay. So it's a savings.
You're already on a lease, or do you have some of the?
No, we're all leased.
Oh, that's good.
Item number nine, approve agreements with the IU 13 for 2019-2020 Head Start program. Consent? Item number 10, approve increase in breakfast and lunch prices for 2019-2020 school year as follows.
And at 5:04 every day, if you do not pay that, you will get in trouble.
Just got one today. 15 cents negative.
At 5:04 every day, it's 5:04. Time is 5:04. Your daughter,
is this like advice?
10 cents. Is it delinquent?
Yes. Or at 5:05. You must be before me.
Oh my gosh.
Are we expecting like a regular increase yearly from them?
So what you do is there's, and I wasn't Michelle and Steve did it this year. You put your numbers in of into a state, it's like a state evaluation tool, and they basically say, you know, you should increase your prices to make sure that your money from the National School Lunch Program isn't being overcompensating for what your students that are paying are paying. So they do this analysis, they look at it, and the state recommends. And they recommended to us a 5 to 10 cent raise. We went with the 5 cent. I uploaded the other averages in the county to compare, and we're right in the middle for all of them. And that's with last year's prices.
Questions or discussion?
Poster, see, I was close with the other ones. For football insurance in the amount of $3,410 and voluntary student accident insurance in the cost of the district for 2019-2020 school year. No rate increase.
Harley, is it as usual?
Consent?
Right.
Number 12, authorize business office staff to make budget transfers as needed for the year-end audit.
Every agenda that I've seen for the last 2 weeks.
Number 13, adopt the final budget. Which was the 2.7.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm doing the millage. Sorry.
Okay.
Yes, the percentage of
the 2%. I know the millage is the more important all around, but it's easier to keep. Consent or discussion?
I think it has to be discussion because it's a financial.
Item number 14, the child care exceptions clarification.
Discussion on this. Bounced around a little bit over the past couple of months, and this has to do with exceptions. So, you guys will be explaining the background on this, but with regard to transportation from certain daycares to the district, an ongoing issue. And I think there's, I know for me, and I found out more today that it was kind of being interpreted two different ways from even some board members and from the administration. So I think we need to clarify that. He and I spoke this briefly earlier and say, hey, let's get this on the agenda so we can make a vote and kind of come to a decision so we get that information out to the public once and for all. Two ways, I'll share the two ways I've heard interpretation now. And one, I was originally under the understanding that what we're eliminating was buses going zone to zone. So I'll use examples because I don't know the area in the daycares, but if you have somebody, if you lived in Lickdale, send your child to a daycare in Jonestown. What we've been doing in the past is, and we were going to eliminate, as far as the exception was, there will be no more transportation. Your child attends daycare in Jonestown, and buses not going to take them across zones, and then you come back over to Lickdale, but they would have to attend Jonestown. That's one way it was being interpreted. Exactly, but you know, and there's a different interpretation, meaning what I heard today from board members and what I hear is being considered is wherever your home is where you go to school. So the only school district, so no matter where you send your child, we will only transport Jonestown to Jonestown School District, Jonestown Zone, Jonestown School District. If you're looked down, you send your child there, not our issue, essentially, is what you're saying. You got to figure out a way to get your kid back to Lickdale. That's where you need to be enrolled.
Yep.
Am I saying that correct?
Yes.
Are we talking, not to interrupt here, but I know we'll have a chance to.
This is a discussion.
Are we talking just transportation, or are we talking where you live is where you go to school? Because those are two different conversations.
Where you live is where you go to school.
Uh-huh. It is kind of two different, but it is,
It was, I mean, when we discussed it, it was, I mean, primarily the biggest daycares, but it started because we had requests from smaller daycares. So we were not providing transportation for those students in smaller daycares, but we were providing it for the larger ones. And it seemed at that point, when we discussed it last year from March through April, that we shouldn't be transporting from a daycare for convenience of the daycare to get those students. So it was, it's not that if you move the daycare over Jonestown lines, now you have to get all of those kids to East Hanover or wherever that would be. It's
wherever you're designated is where you go to school.
Well, and I think part of that too is when we had discussed looking forward with the numbers and crowding in different places, we need to be consistent. So I think to project that, you can't predict where a daycare is going to come, and we can't predict where people are going to have developments. However, we can control that more than we can control this childcare. I'm not sure where the exceptions came in, but we had been talking about that, slowly removing that just so we can look specifically, use those numbers to project out. If we have to redistrict at some point, but to have that childcare component to part of that is just muddies it. And I think there's a lot of different things that then become issues. Is the smaller childcare, where do you say a bigger childcare? There's just too much to it. So I think it just needs to be consistent. You go to school, where are your homes?
Is it that simple? And I hate to make it complicated, because I'm assuming you don't have the same type of like specialized classroom in every single elementary for a student who might need support. Is it possible that a student might have to cross attendance zones in order to attend a school where they get support?
Well, I think that would be an IEP. I mean, we still have to be accommodating district wise. That would be an IEP.
Sure, but it would have implications relative to it that child goes to and from a preschool or a child care.
Sure.
And I think the other question, if you're saying, if you know, there's an issue of transportation, there's an issue of attendance exceptions. You can have a standard about where you go to school with exceptions for, are there exceptions outside of students with disabilities that we're saying, hey, you can go to this school because
for
you asked us?
As long as I've been here, the exception was always, it used to just be if you remember that you went, if you had a daycare in Jonestown, you went to Jonestown. You had a daycare, so you either went to where your daycare was or where your home was.
Oh, interesting.
So, like, if you had,
wow.
And I think
that's not attendance then.
Well,
that's
true. Different.
Yeah.
And it's still like that, actually.
Huh.
But go ahead.
Yeah, that's. I think that's because. Then I think it was maybe about 3 or 4 years ago.
It was right before I came. This is my fourth year.
Jonestown was overcrowded, and so then they kept that same rule, but they said if you go to a daycare in Jonestown, you can't go to Jonestown. We only want Jonestown there.
So it's like all these little things.
There's,
yeah, like
I mean, it's different, and it's benefiting some and some not. Mm-hmm. So it was just a very, like.
My only concern would be that there are, like in East Hanover, like you know, there's no daycares. So then you're saying to those, you have people at East Hanover that use daycares wherever. Some go to Frederick, you know, they might go to Noah, or they might go to, the only ones that are getting bused back to East Hanover are the ones currently in Jonestown, because you guys put that ban on, you can't come into Jonestown, and then we ran into that. But I think it worked pretty well the way it was before, where, you know, I mean, I could show you the numbers, but if you're at a daycare in Lickdale, then you can have that exception to go to Lickdale because that's where your daycare is, and that busing, there's probably already a bus stop there that doesn't add busing or transportation to anywhere.
I think the thing, I definitely understand that, and I think it's been past practice, but I think as a district, we just have to make a decision just to make it clean. And I think, unfortunately, you know, that was the reason that we had kind of given the guidance the last 2 years to kind of start phasing that out so people can start planning for that. And I mean, that I drove my daughter to back and forth for years because she didn't live. And then we did have the convenience of having the same daycare within. So I've seen both sides of it, but unfortunately that's something families have to plan for, and they have to plan for that in all districts.
Well, I think it allows the thriving of the smaller daycares, because essentially you're saying one area doesn't have daycares, but that's probably because a lot of the smaller ones that may have taken on 4 or 5 students couldn't compete with the larger ones, because the larger ones had so much of a larger just facility, they could offer more, they started expanding, and now you can get your kids bus, so you don't have to worry about driving them to and from. So I think it also comes down to one of the larger daycares has their own transportation. They have a large bus. The other daycares that are, you know, financially capable can individually drive students, or the parents make arrangements by a family member to drop the student off in the morning. I mean, it's just, it's kind of a
I hate that it's not consistent no matter what we do if we're making
exceptions. Can I pose a question? Mm-hmm. So if you had, are we saying your bus stop is also only at your home? So if you have a student that's in Lickdale School District, goes to Lickdale Daycare, does their bus have to pick them up at their house, or can the bus pick them up to Lickdale Daycare?
Well, and I think that has to go through transportation, because that's one thing that...
That's a transportation, yeah.
You know, we have different bus stops, and I know you can contact transportation and say, hey, can you just pick up my kid here, and then you sign a paper or whatever, and then they just change your bus stop and get a new card in. So I don't think that that's a...
So the kids at the Lickdale Daycare that go to Lickdale can get picked up by the bus, but the East Hanover, Fredericksburg, and Jonestown kids have to get a ride to those elementary schools?
If they're within the distance. If they're not within walking distance would be, I mean, if there's a bus stop.
So the daycare is responsible to get those
kids in.
So, I mean, the straight standard of the school code is you are, if you decide to provide transportation as a school district, then you have to provide transportation to and from a residence. Anything you do above and beyond that is completely within your discretion to make up the rules. They should be fair, and they should not encourage people to live in one place but try to get their kid into a daycare to get into that elementary. And there should be some predictability about where someone buys their house to know that they might be going to a certain school. Or maybe you don't care. Maybe you want people to buy houses wherever because they can buy their way into a daycare in the elementary school they want to attend. But the standard rule is you only have to provide transportation to and from a residence. And then anything else you should have should be an organized series of, like, we're agreeing to provide transportation. Some districts will not transport to and from in-home daycare, because any person could become an in-home daycare person, and then you're transporting all over. Some people do it by attendance zones. Some people do it by, you know, they have to be certain large daycares. So it really, that's all within your discretion.
Explain what you mean by attendance zones.
So in some districts, especially large districts, they only transport within attendance zones. So you live here. Your attendance zone is that elementary school there, and we're not going to have a lot of transportation that goes between attendance zones. Everyone's going to be going to a certain hub. Now, there are exceptions that have to be made, but often if you get a request for, say, parents with 50-50 custody, and they both have houses in the district, the question is, do I have to provide transportation to both residences? Well, it sometimes depends on whether we even have a bus run that goes that way, because we might have all of our buses going only within one attendance zone and not jumping between because the district is so large.
What if I, as a parent, my kids go to Jonestown, and I decide I want my kids to go to East Hanover? Can I do that?
I don't know what your current rules are. I'm hearing a version of it's not necessarily residence that controls where you go to school.
Currently, you could do that if your daycare provider was in East Hanover, in that scenario.
So what, like, if I offered to provide transportation?
I think that's one.
It can be denied.
I mean, yeah, that would be considered an attendance exception if you had a standard rule.
Okay.
But it doesn't sound like you have a standard rule.
I guess it'd be important. I mean, how many kids from the numbers we ran, how many kids are affected? Or what's the number?
Like, I mean, the current, you know, and I don't care which way you're going.
Right?
Yeah, really, so you have to have standard rules so you can predict what your transportation is, and so you also know where
to go. Well, that was
and
the point of the year.
Correct. You cannot, like, project and plan for the future. There's all these exceptions, so I think it should just be included.
I guess the one question, maybe, Leanne, this is a question for you, because I think about YMCA and the SAP program. Mm-hmm. How would they be affected?
They don't go to homes, do they? Can I get clarification?
They don't go to homes.
They go from district building to district mm-hmm. building. They do not go
correct.
To residents.
They get
so
dropped
I do
off.
Not, yeah, I don't see that as even being in this same category. I think that the daycare
so we would,
is
but they technically
separate.
Are daycare, and that's, I mean,
that's
they're before school daycare and after school
yeah.
daycare. They are an exception.
So SAP would be an exception.
So
if
SAC,
that's a decision.
Then only kids in Jonestown, or only residents of Jonestown, would be able to take advantage of SAC as a provider.
Because it is hosted in a district building?
It's hosted in Jonestown.
That's an exception that's, you can make. You mean each of these are exceptions you could have, but they need to be standard.
I think the fact that it goes district building to district building puts it in a separate bubble. We're not transporting to residential homes. We're not, you know, picking the kids up from East Hanover to get them to Jonestown, like, from their home. So we're not driving them from East Hanover Elementary to their home, picking them up, and then taking them to
but
SAC.
How,
it's building to building.
How do you see that as different than, like, a daycare? I guess I'm confused. Because
do they provide free services to any students based on income?
SAC?
I'm not yet. Do they?
I don't know. I have no idea.
That would be one of, I mean, if they provide any type of free services, I think that that would be
something to look at if they're not necessarily gaining an income from a student that we're transporting versus a business that is getting an income?
But there are some that babysitting, and I'm not trying to argue. I'm just trying to think of all of the things.
We have
families. Have a lot of grandparents who, I have one currently, their home school is Fredericksburg. They come to East Hanover because their grandparents aren't getting paid. They're not.
But they're not providing transportation, are they?
No, they...
They're just using... Right. So they go to the other zone, if you want to call it that.
Yes, and then they just get picked up there and go to East Hanover. So it's not going across.
Yeah.
But that's not where that child lives.
No.
Yeah. And I think that's problematic.
Yeah.
That is so problematic.
It's just... It's a lot. Like, it's... I mean, and it's hard because this is kind of... When you have the little individual elementary schools versus having one unit, I mean, these are the problems that it creates. And unfortunately, that's just kind of where we're at. That's, you want your hometown school, that creates kind of problems for parents of, you know, transportation, and that's what we're seeing. So I think there's just too many different...
To go back to the question that you had posed in light of what you had said, I think that if we're saying no exceptions, I think we have to be consistent that your residence is whatever, where your residence declares your bus stop is your bus stop. And then I think families have to provide that transportation and find ways to do it. And I think you have to, it's unfortunate we haven't had this year to communicate that to families, but I know last year at the time we were kind of hoping that this year would provide that time. But to delay it another year, I think is just not, it's not part of what we need to get this cleaned up.
And I think the special education factor to it, I mean, I know with an IEP when my son went across, mm-hmm. I mean, there was no bus stop. It came right up to our door because that's what we requested. Traditionally, they would have been down the block, but each individual IEP, parents will request mm-hmm. how
yeah,
that
might
is.
Be
and that
special
meaning,
transportation.
Yeah.
And that was across.
I might miss that. So with this, and I keep going back to SAC because I know we could potentially lose the program, and I'm not for it. I'm just asking, so I have answers because I see the SAC people all the time once all this comes out. Will we be, we won't be transporting kids to other buildings from Jonestown YMCA
no.
SAC?
So here's what I was hearing from the board members as they were speaking, was that SAC would still be allowed to be transported to and from the different buildings. So all the elementary schools could still participate in SAC. There would be absolutely no babysitter exceptions. The buses would only come to the residents to pick up. There wouldn't be any pickups or drop-offs at any daycares.
So the bus will not come to Jonestown to pick up kids from SAC to the other buildings?
No, so SAC would still be an allowable exception.
Why?
Students can
all
go
right.
back and forth
okay.
from SAC to Fredericksburg, Fredericksburg to SAC, but there would be no pickup at any of the other daycares that are privately run. So your options are either your own residence or SAC.
And I think that's something that from a district support of our family standpoint, we can say, you know, listen, we can work with the Y if we need to expand them to another building. I mean, this is could potentially be more business for them. You know, this is something we're willing to do for if you need before and after school. You know, we'll transport you from building to building, but we can't make residential exceptions.
And it's going to be something that you have to put into policy because this is where it impacts residency and enrollment. So many, many districts provide an exception for childcare, but they do transportation to and from childcare like it's a residence because many, many parents work and require childcare to get to and from. But the real issue for me is where you allow that person to enroll, because often enrollment is a product of residency. They can enroll in a certain school because that's where they live. That's one area you need to clean up unless you're okay with how it currently is. You could also do attendance zone transportation within, you know, I live in this attendance zone for this school. If I have my daycare there, that's not going to create any routes outside of those normal transportation. Maybe that makes sense. But I think it's probably going to take you a month to get the policy and the rules written out to make sure it is really what you would want to be doing, and that it's not going to disrupt too much of your parent population, because it sounds like you guys have been doing it for a very long time.
Well, that's my concern.
And people
about
still
the,
need daycare.
About the timing of it is, mm-hmm. I don't know that, I mean, I understand what you're saying, like, we want to make it happen, but I also feel like we want to watch the timeline because this doesn't give families.
But Stace, we said that last
yeah.
year.
Yeah.
We said in May last year, we said in March, we got the first letter from somebody in the fall.
Because I wanted to make it happen before the last school year, and it was like, let's give families a year, so I said, okay.
Did you guys study it, like, to see, because like, one of the things that you want to look at is, will you have enough people in each of your elementary schools? Like, if you change where people have to attend, and it's no longer based upon their daycare.
I think that predictability was.
Where will you have children?
I have numbers of like, the exceptions, like, I can tell you how many are, you know.
Are you changing that rule as well? Like, you don't get to go to the school where your daycare is?
Correct.
You're also saying that, okay. Because I think that could have a big impact on how many students you have attending.
We have one daycare that's walking distance to a school.
And whether you have enough time to make transfers of teachers if you need to have different grades.
Fredericksburg.
I think that's the hard thing, and that's where I would definitely maybe need your voice from the board, but we have given that direction to say, you have this year to kind of work these things out. And reflectively, I think when we're done, so we kind of realize that nothing had really happened. Now here we are, like it's another year. So
is it something you, I mean, it, could you make some small tweaks now, but put this on the plate of an incoming superintendent? I mean, you have to be able to implement it too. And between now and when you start school, if it changes teachers' assignments, that could certainly complicate things. I'm not saying that it will, but it could, right?
I think there's potentially two large facilities that we're really looking at, and the numbers from those two large facilities, if I'm correct. I think that if the one in Fredericksburg, I think they get exceptions to walk across the street. So if their home residence is not Fredericksburg, they may be attending Fredericksburg because it's right across the street.
Oh, wow.
So I think that's, I mean, I do think that there's the planning and everything, but what I'm struggling is that means we're going into year three. And the first reason the discussion started was 2 years ago when I was back in Buildings and Grounds. It came 2 years ago, last year, I don't think it's all muddled. When we first discussed it, we were receiving requests from smaller daycares, smaller facilities that were being denied transportation while we were also providing transportation to the larger facilities. And so at that point, 2 years ago, it had started the discussion to weed it out. And then we had Matt Zellers come in, the former transportation director, at the March meeting this past year, and tell us, 2018, March, that March 13th, 2018, he presented the child care, which he showed it was, you know, cost neutral for this year. So we said, okay, since it's cost neutral, let's look at the process and the steps moving forward so that we implement it correctly at the end of the year. This is now the end of that year. So I worry about what might happen between now and
then.
It's a difficult situation, obviously, since I became more intuitive. I'm concerned, I mean, there's timing, to get information out to parents. I don't know what the impact is on parents. Again, I thought, I'm glad we clarified, because I had one understanding of what it was, and other than what all the discussion, I wasn't intimately involved with the topic at that time. I've since become intimately involved with the topic. I was comfortable with when we were saying if you're enrolled in the district, you have the option. I was really focused on what I thought was the issue was the transportation pieces on across zones and that piece of it. So where your child was going, daycare, babysitting, we can enroll them, but we weren't going to take them. Child was attending daycare, goes down, take them back to East Hanover. That's where I thought the discussion originally was. But I support, and as we got more into discussion, I sort of support home residences where you attend. I mean, that's just clean, it's easy, and that's the go forward. How we make that transition based on the timing, because there are expectations, not quite sure what the expectations, again, were how they were communicated, but the timing is the issue. I think we need time, so is there a happy medium here, maybe is what we need to figure out, or something so that we'll move in the right direction, but is there a happy medium?
As board, how can we ensure that it's going to happen this year? I think that's my biggest concern, is feeling like we sat here a year ago and said, okay, we want this to happen. It's time to make this happen, you know. And I go back even years ago when I was first on the board, the whole redistricting problem and all these, and taking that one piece out, we kept saying, we need to clean up this whole daycare thing. And I felt like it was so clear a year ago. So that's my hardest thing, honestly, Ed. I mean, I definitely support admin recommendation, but it is really hard for me to sit here knowing that the direction was really clear last year.
And with all due respect, I mean, I know her and I are, you know, as building principals, we've had these discussions, and we know, I mean, we've been, I remember the board meeting you guys referenced, and I'll be the first to apologize. If this fell on us and we were supposed to initiate this, then, I mean, I'll speak for me. I apologize. I mean, there was, I'm not going to sit here and blame anybody, but, you know, I think a lot has gone on in a year, and that directive to say, and I'm not talking about in a board meeting, I'm talking about outside the board meeting, the directive to say, hey, John and Melissa, and Bill, I mean, there's three elementary principals, too. I'd like to, you know, obviously say, you know, you three, let's make this happen. I mean, I don't recall that happening outside of a board meeting. So I just want to kind of, and I'll be honest, I want to defend her and I here because I get it. There's frustration. This is a lot, no matter what decision we decide here. And communication, as we always hear and say, I mean, communication is key, and we got a lot of people involved here, so.
Could you get information between now and the next board meeting, like data on the number of kids that will impact if you change the rules?
I have that.
Okay.
It's
probably not an easy conversation for now, but I mean, if you want to share it, you can. It's up to you.
Well, I mean, for 1920, because parents fill out the paperwork. You have to fill out a paper, and then it goes like, so I can, there's 26 current kids that are requesting a different school for like a babysitting exception. Now those are all kids that
to attend a different school or to be transported.
So like if they live in Lickdale and they have a babysitter in Fredericksburg, they're requesting to attend Fredericksburg.
It's an attendance exception.
That's not a transportation. So we're not providing transportation for all 26 of those students.
These 26 are ones that like that example I gave, if there was a bus stop at that, they could be transported, but they're within, like if I take my kid to Fredericksburg and there's a bus stop at that daycare, then my kid does get transported to Fredericksburg. If they go to Noah,
it's not across, I guess.
No,
we'll say the lines.
It wouldn't be across, right.
So it truly is an attendance exception because transportation, the hub is already set up.
Right.
And they're gonna get on the bus with the other kids.
Right.
Yeah, when you look at these kids, none of these child care providers are the big ones, the big boy providers that
they're
we're all aware
individual circumstances.
Of. These are all, I mean, you see some of these there.
Well, those are because the other kids that didn't have to then fill out the exception were the Jonestown kids who were getting bused back to their home schools. They didn't fill out the exception because they were coming to their home school. So those were the transportation requests. Those kids, there are 24. There's 24 current kids who are going to a daycare in Jonestown who are getting transported to their home schools.
Okay. So we're transporting 24 students from a facility to their home school.
In
so going
Jonestown.
Across. Okay.
Yes, going across. Okay.
And the majority of that is the big one in Jonestown and the SAC program.
So I mean, I think at least maybe a possibility, at least for a year, like if you just took off the they can't go into Jonestown anymore, it's actually pretty much of a wash because of the learning mill. I know the learning mill was here last month talking about, you know, how they want their kids to be transported to home school. If we went back to at least maybe for a year of how it used to be, like where you go.
We still have a second large facility in Jonestown though. Well, within
what?
Jonestown School District. Christie's and the Learning Mill are two.
Learning Mill's in Lickdale.
Lickdale. It moved
it's not
across the bridge.
Anymore, like, yeah.
Yeah, but I'm saying Jonestown would still be in that Jonestown hub. So if we go back to what it used to be.
So what happens then is those 24 kids who are getting transported out, worst case scenario, is those 24 kids would then be allowed into Jonestown. Right? If we say you go to the school where your daycare is, those 24 kids would then be allowed to go. We wouldn't have to provide transportation to anybody, you know, unless they're in daycare. That is kind of evened out because Learning Mill has 26 kids that are currently going to Jonestown because you allow them to finish out the year even when they moved over to Lickdale. Those 26 kids should be coming to Lickdale. So it's kind of an even wash of
as far as
where,
numbers go.
Oh, as far as numbers of kids.
Yeah.
As
everyone.
Yeah.
And then you have the 24 kids who have never been affected because they're just between the smaller schools. Like if I'm at Lickdale and I had sent my kids to Noah's, then that there's 24 of those kids that haven't been transported at all. So like if you would go back to just making the attendance exceptions, you would not be transporting anybody across district lines.
Or zones.
Isn't that really what we're trying to eliminate? We're trying to eliminate the transportation.
Not regularly offering the same transportation to smaller mom and pops. But we haven't been, is what I'm saying is my concern, is that we haven't been.
But there were smaller ones in Jonestown. Like, I'm not, so it wasn't, it was any daycare in Jonestown. So there were smaller ones in Jonestown, like mom and pop ones on here. There are some of these that are single parent ones. I mean, I don't think it had to do with the size. I think it had to do with Jonestown was thought to be overcrowded, and we just didn't want any kids to be going into Jonestown. So anybody that was going to a daycare in Jonestown, whether big or small, got transported out to their home school. It didn't have to do with the size. I mean, they had a couple of the large ones there, but they have small ones too.
No, they'll all go to Jonestown. I guess we should talk about what the objective is. Is the objective to make it fair for daycares, or is the objective so that we can plan ahead and count where our students are?
That is the biggest thing, is just to take that away, to be consistent, so we have consistent numbers that hopefully we can use to project. Because eventually, just looking, we've been talking for years that we need to redistrict, and we can't do that until this part is taken out.
And I can see that. I think it would be a really drastic change, and as a parent who works in a school district and other parents, some parents do have far commutes because we are a rural school district, and to say that you have to have it at your residence, I think we would at least need to consider saying, okay, if you're in Lickdale but you can have a babysitter in Lickdale, we will pick up at that.
Well,
but as long as you're going
saying.
To your home one. I think stripping it away
but
from everything.
But that's what she was saying, was initially you can request that transportation if you're in your hometown. If a bus stop is within that area of that babysitter, but we weren't going to transport anybody across.
Well, I was just addressing, because it was said at one point that a bus would only come to your residence. And I was just saying, for homes where there's two working parents, I think that's an extremely harsh determination, like, to put on two working parents.
I think flipping it from comes to residence is comes, you know, to the school, like your home school by your residence.
And that's what I'm trying to get
to. Yeah,
could we maybe do that for the next year?
If you look at your attendance zone, if you do it by where the daycare is, wouldn't it save you guys money? Because if you had 10 kids at the daycare, if you had to individually pick up at home, that's 10 stops. If you pick it up at the daycare, that's one stop. That saves you time on the bus, gas, mileage.
Well, not necessarily, because we have like 15 kids at the corner of our road.
Well, that's
just
not how
the
bus reimbursement works from the state either. It goes by mileage and students on the bus at the time. So technically, it could hurt you in some cases, and it could help you in other cases where you're really close to the mileage.
That's
so
why we had
that's
Mr.
Not,
Zeller come in, because that was a little squeaky. It seems like it should be that way.
Like, that's our, like, direct cost, yes, but then the reimbursement comes into play, and it doesn't always balance out the way you think on a direct cost level.
And that, like, to your point, which I think is important, if you're trying to streamline the rules, then you have to remember where it impacts. So we want to get more organized and know how many students might be coming into a district because, we have a huge new development coming in. So now we know we're going to have 100 new kids. So if that's your long-term goal, it doesn't mean that you have to eliminate every exception, because in every attendance zone, you're always going to have people who are working, who are going to have who are at least going to say to you, please, can we have some sort of exception to this? Or would you transport to and from a daycare or, you know, a babysitter or something else?
Or a neighbor's house.
That to me is, like, if you address that issue, that's not addressing the attendance zone issue and trying to get your numbers correct. Because that is...
And I agree with that.
For parents, that is a short notice. 3 months. I mean, it's not a legal, that's not legal advice. I don't know how available babysitters are over the summer to say, hey, are you available in September? Because things are going to change. So I think that's a consideration. You can even it out without destroying every little opportunity for parents to have an option. Because it doesn't have to be just to and from residents.
Yeah,
you already have daycares that are transporting, and you have hubs in those places. So that's
fine
good.
With that if you want to put that recommendation together.
Like in the wording, so
yeah.
That it's not.
So can I just go over again what I'm hearing to summarize it so that we have it correct next week? Okay. So SAC, like we said, will still be allowed to bus to and from all the elementary schools. There won't be babysitter exceptions unless it was in within your home district. So if you reside in the Lickdale Elementary School District, you may have a babysitter in that school district and we will pick up from there. If you're in Fredericksburg, you may go to a Fredericksburg daycare and we will still provide your transportation. But you must go to the elementary school of your home residence. It's basically what we're trying to accomplish. Is that
right.
Your objective?
Yes.
Okay. I can work on that
is
for
that
next
clear?
Week.
Is that
you guys okay with that?
Yeah, we can always
that going. I think, like I said, I think the only problem you're going to run into is we have some schools like East Hanover that don't have.
What about
all the
Methodist?
They don't. I'm not saying that there's none. I'm
just
saying
a
that
there's preschool.
Yeah,
I know my son
is
there.
Yeah,
that's
but there's,
that's
not a daycare. I think I'm
yeah.
Sort of like two
sorry.
In home. There's not like a.
The next topic would be clustering at that point.
And
yeah.
I think that
so.
There's we're not the type of people that aren't going to work with families either. So I think let's
have a form that covers. I mean, like basically, transportation and attendance exceptions are going to go hand in hand. Going to have a form for each, but you're going to have a streamlined set of rules so that when people need an exception, it's
yeah.
It's on each one of those issues separately, and that way principals can play in.
Yeah, we do.
I
have
mean, we have,
yeah.
We have, like, we know what kids are
right.
Are going because
right.
They have to be in, but, like, that's on a timeline. Except, right. Like, we could tell you, I mean, that's how I have this
yeah.
Number. We
yeah.
Know the kids and
yeah.
Where they're going because they've gone, like, some of these kids have gone to live, have been on an exception for, you know, like, to four, and now we're going to tell them in five, like, you're going to have to switch. I mean, that's going to be
fun. Well, that's why I threw out the example of being at Jonestown and wanting to go to East Hanover, because I know the numbers are lower there. So if I decide that I want to send my kid to East Hanover for whatever reason it helps me babysitting-wise, I would hope that we would allow parents like myself to be able to put an exception in if that's going to benefit my family. So that's where I'm.
I think if it was for babysitting, that's a request you can make. But just as you, as a parent who lives in Jonestown, because there's smaller class sizes in East Hanover, you want to drive your student there. That's been denied in
no,
the past.
No,
I mean,
just, I'm just talking.
Babysitter-wise is.
Well, I'm talking about babysitting, and if the babysitter is willing to provide the transportation and it's not a burden to the district, I don't know why we wouldn't make an exception for that.
Well,
do you know
they
what I'm
can,
saying?
But we're not saying that we're not trans.
What do you
I
mean
the
they
attendance,
can?
But I think that that's the difference between the attendance and the transportation, or are we putting these together? Is that the one that you're...
Well, that's what I'm struggling. I'm just struggling with if we have a family who has a situation that they need daycare and it is going to benefit the numbers in a classroom. I mean, that's not why they're putting their child there, but if it's benefiting the numbers in the classroom, why wouldn't we make that exception?
Because we need
I
to have
think,
a clear idea of how
I
many students are in each
up.
School.
So if
I mean,
you start to hear that numbers are going to be really high in one building, now you know.
We won't be able to address the kids that can't afford to get driven or go to another babysitter to go to that elementary school.
Yeah.
I mean, we're benefiting some kids, but not others. So I think it's...
I mean, we know. I mean, it's only unpredictable in that if there's new kids that come there, but like it's pretty much the same 20-some kids every year that have been getting
their siblings.
And there's,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Like we get those forms early in the spring because parents know they have to fill those out, and we can see the numbers if there's class sizes that are large. There have been times that we have.
Well, you could always set a cap too that you could accept exceptions for attendance purposes, and transportation purposes up to a point unless it starts to impact the numbers in a classroom or the numbers in a building. And there's lots of caveats that you can do here in a really organized way so that it doesn't seem like every person has cut a special deal for their certain right. circumstances, but yeah. if you need to do that,
and that's what it sounds
then it might
like.
Be allowable.
Yeah, and I think, Mrs. Murray, you kind of said that before the class size when you were talking about if you need a babysitter or you need childcare. So that kind of goes back to the weekend. I just want to make sure I'm clear, too.
I know. I'm not sure.
Because it is a confusing. I mean, we've gone round and round with these conversations. It's confusing. But so that's my question. Are we leaving it up? Are we talking about potentially leaving it up to the building principals to sign off on that exception still? If a parent would come to us and say, we don't have any other daycare options, we need...
I think that puts a lot of weight on you guys.
But I know.
I don't think the district should be doing that.
I don't think that's
I don't want the district to do
okay.
that.
And that's fine, but I kind of thought I heard that.
I don't
know. Again, yet the okay.
These roles are these roles.
That's
it.
That's why I was like, mm-mm. I don't think I wanted to.
That would be chaotic.
Because it implicates financials.
I think we're moving forward. Compromise, you just explained, which is kind of what we're doing. You asked about a formal process. I think what happens is the actual policy, which could cover some of these caveats. We'll upset, get that policy approved to start of next year. A formal letter goes to parents. This is the last year. This is the policy going forward.
That's because you'll have three policies that could potentially change depending on how detailed they are right now. And you obviously need a first and second reading for those.
If you push them to the top of the line, you know, I won't.
I know.
I'll leave work.
Yes. And I think that's just what I need to hear. It's just that there is going to be a timeline and it's going to.
Plan accordingly.
It's going to happen.
Yeah.
And we're trying not to be those micromanagers and be.
Right.
You know, so I think that was the hard thing for me is just to say, you know, I thought we would not be having this again this year. But yes, moving forward, this is it. This is it.
So what
see me on video because I'm going to show it again and say.
It got muddled for a lot of reasons.
So what are we doing for next year? Like, are we changing anything for next year?
Are we doing
right
this?
We
this
that.
Is, yes.
We read that.
Yeah. So this is what's happening next year. Well, they'll vote on it next week.
Okay.
Well,
this is the item.
I thought you were saying wait a year.
Oh,
I was wrong with the
I'm not waiting a year for all of that. No.
I want to hear what this is first.
Okay.
This is the one that I had read previously.
Okay.
So what I had heard everyone saying here at the table, the board members, was that for 19-20 school year was like the SAC kids, we would still provide transportation across school district lines between the elementary schools. There would not be babysitter exceptions in other elementary school districts. You will attend the elementary school in which you have residence. If you have a daycare that's providing you services within the same elementary school of where you reside, the school bus can pick you up at that daycare. But you won't be able to have a daycare in another elementary zone from where you live. So you can't live in Fredericksburg, have a babysitter in East Hanover, and attend East Hanover. If you're in Fredericksburg, you must attend Fredericksburg Elementary School.
And is the exception to that SAC, though?
Except
any
for
district
SAC.
Hosted program, I think, is a very responsible role. Because the goal is to have programs within districts so parents and kids don't have to go anywhere.
And
it's good for you guys, and it's good for the community.
And that may
so
increase
it's called a district
numbers.
Hosted program.
And then we
and
get
it
another
could go into
but
other
they
buildings.
Can only take so
well,
yeah.
based on their staffing, they'd have to go look
if
at another building.
If they have increase in numbers, they'll look at
mm-hmm.
it.
But I mean, it does really encourage
those
programs that you host to be premium programs. I've
Absolutely.
Seen that in other
I think it's the want and the need that you see change in a community as well. Because right now you have smaller, like, and I know you're saying that we have exceptions for single parents, but I've personally seen within our own development offers of, you know, can only take students that reside and are an attending Jonestown Elementary. They don't take students from Fredericksburg because they can't transport them because they have littler kids. They have to walk everybody to one bus stop. So I think in some of those rural areas, you see that change, that, you know, there's a need. You'll see that need get filled as parents will need to do it. I mean, that's everywhere.
As far as process, though, you won't be able to approve a policy change next week because it won't have SAT. I mean, you have a process that says you have first and second readings, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, I mean, you can get the word out and have this be the rules, but it sounds like it's going to change what you do administrative regulation-wise as well as with the policy in at least three areas.
Well, it's nice to get this with DB Fisher
so
sure taking over now, too.
So I'm just telling you, like, you can give the word this is how we're going to operate, but you won't be approving the formal policy next week. I don't think you can unless you want to make an exception to your policy approval process.
Yeah.
Totally up to you guys.
No, let's talk
right.
about word exceptions for a while.
Yeah.
Let's just.
So to be on.
So we can look at what it implicates,
mm-hmm.
and you can plan for what the rules are going to be, but it will be in there in language, not until the July meeting.
It's the first August.
Or August.
Tentative adoption.
Yeah.
Will it go on as, can it go on as tentative adoption for this month and then?
Yeah, you can try to have a first reading by Tuesday.
Yeah.
It would just mean that you'd have to have the, each of these policies that it implicates change, if your policies read that specifically. If it doesn't and it's all in administrative regulations, it's a different story.
I don't think we even have policies.
We don't have policy on the exception.
I was saying, we don't have policy.
I looked for the exception policy.
But it might say, a lot of districts will say transportation is provided to and from childcare babysitters in the discretion of the district. So you might just need to add something like that in accordance with administrative regulations or something that simple. Some districts really lay it all out, like we have attendance zones, we don't transport, I mean, it just depends.
I'll look again.
I don't remember because I haven't looked at that section in a while.
Search words.
I'll look and I won't commit. I mean, beyond that, it's a simple modification like that.
Yeah, I'm searching words on board docs.
Yeah, no, it's not a whole new policy. I think it's something that just gives you liberties. Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, we'll give you the liberties and then this is an administrative regulation that says this is what we're doing this year.
Yeah. All right, we are going to move right to curriculum and human relations committee. Which one is here?
I don't want to move. Please tell me it says curriculum.
Says finance.
Can curriculum be over here, Pat?
Sure, curriculum's right here and human relations over there.